Before we begin the panel, I just wanted to share just one thought on the civil rights movement. The political commentator, Melissa Harris Perry, said there's something really wrong with the King Memorial. It's right that it's in the mall in D.C., but she says that the image is wrong, that King is standing alone. But King didn't act alone in the movement. He didn't act alone, and others didn't need him to take action as well. There would be no King, there'd be no successful leader if it weren't for the courage and conviction of all the others who acted during the civil rights movement. And he acknowledged that during his 1964 Nobel Prize acceptance speech. He accepted the Peace Prize on behalf of the Montgomery movement, not just on behalf of himself. So while it's right that we honor him this weekend, I also want to honor the countless others who moved as well, who put their lives on the line for us. It takes a beloved community to create a beloved community. And so I want to just show you some images, a slideshow of images. The song that you're going to hear is by Ben Harper, and the lyrics are poet Maya Angelou's from her poem, Still I Rise. So we called together this esteemed panel, and I'm going to introduce each person and give them 5 minutes or so to share, again, the work that they're doing in the their own beloved communities, their own work of creative maladjustment. And I wanted to start with the man who's come the farthest to be here with us, and that's Bernardo Nante. Bernardo came from Argentina today. Not just today, he didn't. A couple of days ago. He was born in Buenos Aires. Dr. Nante is a professor of philosophy of religion at the University of Salvador in Buenos Aires. Dr. Nante primarily investigates the interrelation between psychology, religion, and comparative Western Oriental philosophy. A visiting professor in various national and international universities and institutions, Dr. Nante is also founder and president of the Human Vocation Foundation. He specializes in the sources of Jung's work and in translating and commentating on alchemical studies, and he's edited several volumes of the Spanish edition of Jung's collected work. His recent publication includes a book called Jung's Red Book, Keys for the Understanding of an Incomprehensible Work, and a guide to reading to the reading of the Red Book of C.G. Jung. Welcome.
Thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here. Well, first of all, I'm glad, I'm honored, because for me, Martin Luther King as Gandhi are great examples for the world. But at the same time, I must admit, I feel a bit embarrassed because I'm not an American. But however, I thought I'm a South American. So in a way, I'm included. But I'm also embarrassed because I must admit that when I was asked to participate in this panel, and when I was told that I was going to be asked that question, I thought, well, Bernardo's me, no? You should look spontaneous and even clever. And as I'm a bit old, I can look even wise. I think that I need to cultivate at least more this maladjustment attitude, creative maladjustment attitude, which means, I think, to admit that not only we must be creatively maladjusted outside, but also inside. I mean, to begin with, nonviolence, for example, which was the great example of Martin Luther King and Gandhi, begins in the heart, recognizing that we do have violence. And we do have many negative tendencies. Well, the famous Jungian shadow. And this has to do with my work. Since I was a small boy, I am an introvert and very shy. Now, since I'm old, I'm not shy, but I'm introvert still. And you know, introverts sometimes think that they have all the reason inside, and the world is completely wrong. And outside, they adapt. You know, they look, they are shy. Well, it depends, of course, but I'm telling about myself. So I felt very negatively maladjusted inside when I was a boy, and positively I was, you know, the good guy. But I felt that most elders were unhappy because they were not developing the real calling. No? And that was, I understood that That means that education must be changed, and that was why I studied a lot of things to try to see if is it possible to educate ourselves in developing that divine spark which was mentioned today. And I think that is the challenge of humanity. And it's and to do that, we must also recognize that this calling, which is positive, which is the bliss, as Campbell said, includes recognizing the maladjustment inside. And once we work the maladjustment inside and the also the negative adaptation, not the good one, we are capable, I think, of doing the right creative maladjustment, no? Because it tends to be spiritual. So, I want to make this long story short. Even if I'm professor of philosophy, and that's sometimes is a bit boring, we, not only me, created this foundation, which is called Human Vocation, and which works in this direction. And now our challenge is to, it means that we try to share theoretical and practical knowledge in order to foster this calling. No? We don't give any doctrine, we only share this knowledge. And I think it helps to pacify, so pacifica, does the word pacifica has to do with this? I think it helps to pacify because we... only when we develop our inner calling, we give to the community, to the developed community, what the community needs. And that is what we need all over the world. So, this dream, which is in the heart, it's a dream which we must try to, share all over the world. No, this dream, we must put forward this dream in the north, the south, the East and the West. So it's not only for America, for Americans or South Americans, for the whole world, or maybe for the cosmos. I don't know. Maybe up to that. So just to finish, because I would like to share a small story, which in a way is a synthesis of what I'm saying. No, it's a small story. It's an anecdote. Told by Raymond Panikkar, which took place when Kennedy had created an aid program to help the so-called Third World. A young American went to a little African village to carry out a teaching task. As he didn't want to teach children anything of what he knew because he considered it an act of colonialism, he decided to give gym classes. One day, he arrived at the village with a box filled with candies and told the children, "Look at that tree. The one which stands 100 or 200 meters away. I'll count up to 3, and the one who gets there first will get the reward." The 7 or 8 kids who were taking his class were already nervous. When he counted up to 3, all the children joined hands and ran together. They wanted to share the prize. Their happiness wasn't the happiness of them all. Maybe these kids give reasons for some new foundation of the democratic life, said Panikkar. I would add, humbly, maybe they give us some inspiration for the sharing of spiritual values. Thank you.
Our next presenter is Salud Carbajal. First elected to the Santa Barbara County Board of Supervisors in March of 2004 and was re-elected to a second term in June of 2008. Salud graduated from the University of California at Santa Barbara. He holds a master's degree in organizational management from Fielding University. He served 8 years in the United States Marine Corps Reserve, including active duty service during the 1991 Gulf War. He formerly served as chief of staff to previous First District County Supervisor Naomi Schwartz, Program Director in the Santa Barbara County Public Health Department, Assistant Executive Director of Zona Seca, Parent Involvement Coordinator for the Head Start Program, and Program Director for the City of Santa Barbara Lower West Side Recreation Program. Over the years, Salud's public service has demonstrated a strong commitment to protecting our natural environment and resources, enhancing public safety.
I didn't get rid of that.
and working regionally to address our transportation, housing, and workforce challenges.
Thank you, Dr. Selig, and thank you for your presentation. It was really insightful and really moving. And thank you to Pacifica for hosting this panel and this dialogue. I think it's imperative we do more of this if we're going to really fulfill the maladjustment of the adjustment that I think our communities have made. Before I share a little bit about what I'm doing in my own personal maladjustment in trying to address those issues, I remind us that, keeping with what Dr. Selig said, we have become extremely adjusted as a society. When we look at the poverty rate, who is in poverty? When we look at income inequality, who is on the lower echelon of income equality? When we look who is in our prisons and our jails, who is in our prisons and our jails? When we look at who has not had access to health care or education or higher education, who is or who are the groups that have the less achievement? And yet, the sense of urgency, our adjustment, we see, we understand, but do we act as boldly? Do we dialogue as much and have these difficult conversations? And I will submit to you that we don't do it enough, because as a result, we have these things, these challenges that we see, but we don't act quite as much as what we see. And so coming back to what I'm doing, I have always been inspired by Martin Luther King, by his courage as a person of color, just to have the courage to step up, to feel that I could step up, to make a difference. I got to tell you, as a person of color, the day I was elected, I was still unsure that I would get elected because I'm a person of color. I just wasn't sure if this community that I represent, and I'm so privileged and honored to represent this area, up until the day I was elected, I was insecure about the feasibility of such an act. And I'm very privileged to be where I'm at. When you consider all these challenges, for me, my value system has always been to look at not those who have the most, but look at those who are most struggling in our community. So poverty for me has been a central issue for me to highlight in our community. We in Santa Barbara County did a poverty report during this last recession to really understand how bad. We've always known it's bad. We've always known we have a high rate of poverty in our area. But to really understand it and put it at the forefront of us and our community, we did a study that I think illustrated to us how serious poverty has become in our own backyard. You know, many of us are lucky to have the livings that we have and the quality of life we have, but there are so many that don't. So in terms of my maladjustment, I have tried to really bring to the forefront a lot of those issues and inequities and disparities in our communities that exist, and to try to bring about public policy that has an impact on those individuals who are most in crisis, most at pain, and don't have the luxury to have the type of quality of life that many of us in this room do. So from the poverty study to being able to bring about our highest number in the state of California of uninsured children from 16,000 to 2,000, I'm happy to report to you we've been able to do that. We've been able to invest more dollars with the help of our state legislators, Hanna Beth Jackson, Congresswoman Capps, to be able to invest more money in our mental health system to help those most in need who oftentimes wind up in the jail system. And we're doing more. We're looking at Laura's Law to see how we can adopt Laura's Law to make a better impact in the lives of those individuals who, for no fault of their own, because of their illness, in the jail system, in the criminal justice system, not a system they should be in. Climate change has been another issue that we in Santa Barbara County, I myself, have been involved with. And to be able to really put forth awareness of what this means for our quality of life, those most vulnerable, what it means for everyday living, for our food supply. And I think we've been able to bring a lot of attention to those issues as well. To really understand the plight, I think, of those most in need in our community is to really try to understand where are the windows of opportunity to impact the lives in a positive way of those individuals that are hurting. And I got to tell you about one that we recently put in place. It was the truancy program. And we had done away with the truancy program many years ago. And I've always had trepidation about enacting a truancy program because it felt very heavy-handed, very law enforcement-like, because it's housed in the DA. I think we're very fortunate to have a DA in Santa Barbara County who's very compassionate, used to be a Head Start director. She's just wonderful, Joyce Dudley. And when she came into office, we worked together to enact a truancy program, but not from the standpoint of let's find those youth that are truant so we could criminalize them, but let's find the youth that are being truant in our schools so we could find out why they're being truant. Are they being ostracized in school? Do they have challenging crises at home that we can intervene and help them and their families so that we could get them back to school so that they could live a healthy life and have a real chance at achieving in school so they could do better in the future. So I will tell you that for me, Martin Luther King has been an inspiration and a source of making sure that we're maladjusted, that I'm maladjusted, and always questioning my own existence and my own place as a public servant and a policymaker. Am I giving back? Am I creating value? And if I'm not, then I shouldn't be there. And there's a lot of work that needs to be done. And the more dialogues like this, the more forums like this, we raise the awareness. And I think it helps us step up. And something that I don't think we do enough of is really build cross-cultural coalitions. Oftentimes when we have issues, we only see certain segments in certain audiences, but we need to do better. We need to really work at building coalitions and making sure that we are living the values that we want to live for our entire community. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Good, Theon. Dr. Theon Gordon specializes in social transformation of individuals and communities through communications, programming, and social change. Her work speaks to youth in particular, providing innovative change models or change methods to enhance our future. Dr. Gordon has served as executive director of youth organizations, Coach Art, and A Place Called Home, advocating education, arts, athletics, and health and well-being for underserved youth from chronic illness and autism to at-risk and environmental issues. Dr. Gordon created the Theon Group as a consulting agency when business friends and associates extensively sought her out to be a professional speaker and consultant. And most recently, Dr. Gordon created the Be Girls Project, inspiring girls globally to discover the beauty and strength of their minds and spirits, teaching skills that empower them to more productive lifestyles.
Thank you. Thank you. I just want to say I am honored to be on the stage with such a prestigious panel. And in this container, in this space, Maureen, thank you for bringing this together and putting this space in as it is right now. It's a beautiful space, and in it, I also feel such excitement that I'm just about to overflow. So I'm going to kind of break up the calm and peace that I feel in here because my spirit is such that I just kind of put out in the idea of creative maladjustment. As I think about it, I think there's three areas in which we can get committed to a space like that. And usually people come out and protest. And I've been a protester. I have stood up for my groups and the underserved community, stop violence and do different things in that manner. I didn't always feel comfortable in that space of protest. There's also an area where we can litigate. And I've served as an arbitrator and helped in terms of litigation. And again, it wasn't the space that just I could sit in well. And finally, I found a place that I could make a difference. And I found that in engagement. And in engaging youth and community leaders, I found that there is a lot of creative maladjustment that can be done and that is done. Most recently, I worked on a project with 17 youth where we took them from Watts to Senegal. And it was a major transformational experience. The organization is Foundation for Second Chances. I mentor and guide what most people call nonprofit organizations. And I encourage the groups that I work with to not talk about what we don't do, but let's talk about what we do. And we shift it to social profit organizations. So I work with the social profit Foundation for Second Chances, and we were able to rally and raise funds to take 17 youth from Watts to Senegal. The Peace Corps came in and taught the youth a lot about the culture of Senegal and what they would expect. And one of the reasons for the journey was when I was young, my mother used to always say, whenever we would ask for something, it seemed like, you think you're bad when you have no shoes until you meet a person with no feet. Now, my daughter, I said that to her thinking I could get the same response that my mother got from me. But my daughter, of course, said, well, if they don't have feet, why do they need shoes? And she wanted the shoes. But I figured we would try this again on a different generation with the 17 youth that we were taking. And not necessarily say that to them, but let them experience that they think they live in poverty when they're in Watts until they go to a place where people don't have running water. And it transformed these youth. They came back walking taller. They came back speaking differently. They came back saying, we didn't know it was like this. Nobody told us this. They don't teach us this. This isn't in the books. They didn't tell us it was like this. And that is the creative maladjustment that I've brought into the world and that I try to continue and ask communities to engage. I believe it's in the youth. I believe it's engaging the youth. And that's the small part that I can play and hope that each of you will join in finding some youth that you can show something different. If you just show them something different, there are people that live 2 miles from the beach and have never walked on the sand. It'll be something different to just take them there. And I think that's the contribution that that I've made. So thank you, and thank you for allowing me to share.
Our next speaker will be Dr. Wallace K. Shepherd, Jr. For the past 6 years, under the faithful leadership of Dr. Wallace K. Shepherd, Jr., pastor, God's Open Door Second Baptist continues to be committed more than ever to serving the community. Pastor Shepherd has acted as the chairperson on the board for the Dr. Martin Luther King Committee of Santa Barbara, which has held its annual celebration for the last 6 years, along with Second Baptist Church as one of its main supporters. In January of 2013, the event attracted over 2,000 people, many of whom participated in a march up State Street, reminiscent of the many marches Martin Luther King Jr. initiated. The marchers ended up at the historic Arlington Theater, where an enriching and inspiring program was held that celebrates the life and legacy of King. Looking in the future, in desiring to outreach to all in the community, Pastor Shepherd's vision is to focus on embracing all that want to join the church. He feels that God's open door is a more fitting reflection of this desire.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that introduction, and thank you for your book. I read it, and I liked it. It was very good. Just a quick correction. It's been 9 years at Second Baptist. And believe me, that's why I have gray hair. When I think about the maladjustment that a black man has to make in America, it's tougher than just saying I did a few things in the world. Because we have to make adjustments just for walking down the street. I remember when I was 9 years old, I got put off the bus in Vallejo, California because of my skin color. And I wouldn't go to the back of the bus in Vallejo, California, which I'm 57 years old, so it shocked me. I didn't even know why I was getting put off. I mean, I was saying, hey, I'm just going to stand here. No, I'm sorry, you can't do that. But what I'm saying is that we've had to make adjustments all of our lives throughout everything. We make adjustments when you're told that at the age of 17 that you're not college material because of the color of your skin. You have to make an adjustment and try to figure out what you can do next, or when you're told that you cannot make it because you have a job at a store and you ought to be just happy with that. So what do? We try to find different ways to get through life. We make adjustments as they come. But as you get older, you find out that the little things you do, sure, they can make a small difference. But what really matters today is people changing what's in their heart and in their mind. And if we can get to them to change their hearts and in their mind, then we've really made some adjustments to people. It's the hardest thing to do. I remember talking to a guy, and he said to me, I asked this person, how many blacks do you have working for the city? And he said, well, I think we have 40 of those people. He didn't realize what he had said. Because the problem is that it has been embedded so deeply in so many people to be racist that they don't know when they're making a racist statement. And it makes it, at that particular moment, when you hear something like that, you have to adjust again. Because you want to be friends with this person, you want to shake that person's hand and say, here I am, but all the time, you're wondering what's in their mind and what adjustment you're going to have to make next. So what I did when I came to Second Baptist Church, it was primarily a black church, as they quote unquote call it. But then I said, you know what? Let's make it a church. I said, instead of just being a black church, let us have it as a church. And a church means that you have all walks of life. It means that everybody's the same. Let's put everybody on equal ground. Hard thing to do, because you have some people that have a fair amount of money and their God is their money. You have other people that good jobs, and they can't sit next to somebody homeless, because I say, let's grab the homeless and let's grab the ones that are wealthy. Let's grab the ones that are struggling, trying to make it. White, black, Hispanic, Asian, whatever. Just come on in. That's why we call it God's open door now, because we want everybody there. But it's still not easy. Because then people look at you and they say, well, wait a minute, what kind of church is this? It's an all-inclusive church. That's one of the contributions that I did. I took it from Second Baptist from being just a black church to everybody's church. And that's what we should have. Because when we get to heaven, if you believe in heaven, which I do, God's not going to say blacks on that side, whites on that side, Hispanics over there, Asians right there. He's not going to say that. He's going to say we're all together. So that's it starts in the mind. But I want to say this, and I know I'm probably running out of time, but I want to say this so we can hear this. We all talk about starting with the children. We all say we got to get a hold of the children, which is true. But the problem remains with our elders that have it in their psyche to make sure that they say something negative about another race. Even in their conversations over dinner, something will come out that is very negative. And that's the problem, because people are not born racist. They are made racist by their environment and who they're talking to. So we have to start with everybody and let it trickle down to the youth. That's one of my contributions. The other, I helped form a company called EcoFaith. We did that where we green our churches. The environment's important. Everybody's environment's important. And so the environment being important, people's lives being important, and the psyche of a person is most important. So that's me.
Next, we have the Honorable Hanna Beth Jackson. Former prosecutor and practicing attorney, educator, and small business owner. She was elected to the California State Senate in 2012 to represent the 19th Senate District, which includes all of Santa Barbara County and Western Ventura County. She's a graduate of Scripps College in Claremont with a joint major in government and sociology. She received her law degree from Boston University Law School before returning to California to work as a deputy district attorney for Santa Barbara County. Eventually, she became the managing partner for the law offices of Eskin and Jackson, with offices in Ventura and Santa Barbara. From 98 to 2004, she represented the 35th Assembly District in the State Assembly, where she worked with Democrat and Republican governors to author more than 60 bills into law. And in the Senate now, she is chair of the Senate Judiciary Committee and serves on several key committees, including the Budget Committee, the Environmental Quality Committee, and the Natural Resources and Water Committee, and more.
Thank you very much. Probably for this discussion, the most important is that I chair the Legislative Women's Caucus. And I'll talk about that in a second. When I was asked if I would come and speak today about maladjustment, I thought, my God, I'm a politician. I could never admit to being maladjusted. And then it was explained to me that actually creative maladjustment is a good thing. So being in the political world, I want to make sure I define what we mean by maladjustment. And that is, to be adjusted means to be complacent. To be maladjusted means to be hopefully passionately discontented with a world that needs a great deal of repairing, a great deal of self introspection, or I guess maybe that's redundant, but certainly introspection, and change. And for me, being in the political world allows me to try to help create change, hopefully in a positive way. I want to also say that the I Have a Dream speech I remember hearing as a young girl, it was a motivation to me then, looking out upon a sea of hundreds of thousands of people who had come to Washington collectively to listen to this extraordinary
rhetoric by this incredible man who coalesced the feelings not only of minorities and particularly of African-American minorities in this country, but for all of us, I think, who believe that we can do better and who believe in a just and fair and equitable world. And so for me, I don't want to mothball that speech. I think that speech we should hear every year to call upon ourselves to be better, to remember the notion that it is not the color of one's skin or one's gender or one's religious beliefs. It is the content of our character that should be the judge of all of us, and that opportunity for the content of our characters should be preeminent in the political world as well as in educational opportunities as well. And so I want to respectfully disagree that it's time to mothball something that calls upon us all to be better and to reach and to strive to our higher selves. Certainly there are some who will say in politics, ain't no way that happens. But for some of us in the political world, it really is about doing better. And my calling into the political world actually happened when I was 7. And I was a little girl who wanted to play Little League. And I was quite good, actually. I was the best guy on the team. But I was a girl, and girls were prohibited from playing Little League, and I thought that made absolutely no sense. If I was the best guy on the team, why couldn't I play? Why would I be judged on the basis of something that was totally irrelevant to my skills as a baseball player? And so I went around my neighborhood with a clipboard and a petition. Because my parents told me that in America, you got to redress your grievances. That meant that you could petition the government and petition the powers that be and say, mm-hmm. you're wrong, and here's why, and all these other people agree with me. And I sent out my petition. I went around the neighborhood. Many of you have heard this story, but it is a true story. And some people signed my petition, and some people patted me on the head and told me I should go home and play with dolls or tea sets, even worse. And I remembered those people on Halloween. But I also remember them to this very day. And it has been my strong commitment to recognize that politics is the art of action, or inaction, if you look at what's happening in Washington, D.C. right now. But what you also need to look at is the battle lines that have been drawn. Since when do we glorify wealth and vilify and castigate poverty? And if you look around and you listen to the language that we hear in Washington, D.C. today, if you're poor, it's because you're lazy, because you haven't taken advantage of the opportunities. And if you're rich, well, you've worked hard for that wealth. And you know what? I don't think that's necessarily true. In fact, if you take a look at the obstacles that people have today to achieving the great American dream, you look at abject poverty, food insecurity. Salud talked about the poverty in our own area, where up until a few years ago, we had the highest percentage of children without access to health care in this state. These are shocking, shocking realities that we have got to change. And part of it is we have to change the dialogue, and we have to change the opportunities. And as Americans living in a democracy, we're not going to do that unless we encourage everybody who is able to register and to vote. Because your voice in America really does matter. And even though we have people like the Koch brothers and others who, with their billions of dollars, try to buy elections, they still can only vote once. They have the same vote as the poorest person who has registered and wants to get out to vote. And this is so critically important as we come to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Voting Rights Act. And as we see in many states, again, trying to subdue that vote by creating conditions that will keep people from being able to cast their vote and have their voices heard. So here in California, I did legislation this past year. I looked to see who isn't voting. And the number one group that isn't voting is the 18 to 24-year-olds. And I recall Martin Luther King back in the 60s, condemning the war in Vietnam, while we sent off 18-year-olds to fight that war who were not capable of casting a vote because the voting age was 21. We fought hard to reduce that age to 18, and in today's world, those very same voters are not voting. So what I did was I passed a law that says when a young person turns 16, they're not going to get to vote at 16, but they're going to get to pre-register. They're going to be able to put their name down that says, as soon as I turn 18 and there's an election, you send me my ballot. And part of that is that between the ages of 16 and 18, most schools have something called civics, where young people learn, hopefully learn a little bit about the struggles to get people the right to vote in the civil rights movement, and before that, women's rights, and after that, we've had the challenges associated with some of the very difficult problems with getting people who don't necessarily speak English as their second language, but who have every right to vote. Getting everybody out there, having them learn about the right to vote, having them learn about the responsibilities to vote in a democracy so that their voices are heard, so that people are elected who are going to speak up to the powers, the influences of power that have kept people down while lifting big corporate interests, deciding they have a right, but those people who may look differently or look different, I'm not sure what the correct grammatical thing is, it doesn't matter, because if you're able to vote and you can put an X next to your name, you should have that right. So young people in our state are now going to be able to pre-register so that when they're 18, they understand they've got some skin in the game. They're going to get out there because it is the future that those of us now in power are leaving to them. They need to have their voice heard. So I will end by saying that it is important to give a voice to the voiceless, to encourage those, though, with a voice to speak up and have their voice heard. And as chair of the Legislative Women's Caucus, I am committed to the notion that inequality needs to turn into opportunity, that we need to give women, the caregivers, an opportunity to be able to succeed in life. We need to recognize that the largest group in poverty is women, and particularly women with children, whether they're married or they're unmarried with children. They are the ones who are given the least of a helping hand. Nobody's asking for a hand out. It's a hand up. And we know that the number one source of poverty in this country today is motherhood. When you think about that, we have a lot of work to do, and particularly women of color who don't have access to quality childcare, but we are giving 5 years to stay on welfare in their lifetimes to get an education and raise their children at the same time. We really have a lot of work to do. And so my pledge going forward, as someone who is in the political world where we talk about action, is to hear the voices of the people and to commit to the words of Martin Luther King, that we are going to give everybody the opportunity so that they can be judged by the content of their character, not by their gender, and not by the color of their skin.
Next, we have Aaron Jones, who's Assistant Director for Community Affairs, Student Engagement, and Advocacy. He's also the manager responsible for the following areas: Community Affairs Board, Coastal Fund, Environmental Affairs Board, Bicycle Improvement, Keeps Everyone Safe, Ivy Community Relations Committee, Ivy Tenants Unit, America Reads, America Counts Tutorial Program. He is also the staff lead on local matters, working specifically with the External Vice President for Local Affairs on a variety of interrelated community matters. Jones is also a community historical resource for students. And my notes say, remember Morgan Freeman's character in the movie Shawshank Redemption? Why do my notes say that?
There's my lead-in.
Okay.
I always admired that character because he was the guy that could get things. So I kind of, that's what I tell my students, for those who actually remember Shawshank Redemption. So I just want to thank the organizers, Diane and Pacific Graduate Institute. It's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be on this panel and sitting between these two amazing women, and also to follow Hanna Beth Jackson. Now I'm a little fired up and and ready to talk some. When I was growing up, I grew up in San Francisco, and in the 70s, before Martin Luther King's holiday was an actual holiday, my father used to wake me up and say, "You don't have to go to school this morning." Mm. And I would say, "Why?" He'd say, "Because it's Martin Luther King's birthday." And we would get up and we would watch television and we'd talk and we'd just spend the day together. And I didn't understand the value of that then. It became more clear to me as I grew older, and then the fight for, the literal fight to have Martin Luther King's birthday acknowledged as a national holiday, and seeing the recognition of the importance of that for this country and the healing of this nation, given the history, the egregious history of oppression that is so much a part of the history of freedom of this country, the hypocrisy and the dichotomy that we live in, right? I really, really started to, I really appreciated my father for that. So that was his creative maladjustment for his sons. I did my undergraduate at UCSB and was engaged as a student leader. My colleague Lisa Valencia and I were engaged in the struggle, and I really appreciate what was said in the presentation earlier about, you know, Dr. King talking about like feeling like we're banging our heads against a wall, an impenetrable wall. And I kind of really, I really took it to heart, and really went into a depression, quite frankly, just trying to do this work, feeling the energy and the passion and the motivation behind it, but really not seeing the results or seeing how seemingly insurmountable this task was before us. I ended up leaving Santa Barbara for a bit and coming back and working at the Earthling Bookshop, which some of you may remember. And yeah, see there, right? And my colleague, Charles Caldwell, who was supposed to be here, is not. He was managing the bookshop at that time. And for those of you who don't know, it was like the cultural mecca for Santa Barbara for many, many years on the corner of Annapamu and State Street, and where Old Navy is now, of all things. And in the evenings, especially over the weekends, I mean, it was fantastic. Whoopi Goldberg would come through. We'd see Steve Martin would come with his hat and his glasses on. You know, all sorts of folks would come through. But it was not about the notoriety of the people, the famous people maybe who live locally, but just like the random people who would come through. So one evening, this gentleman, this older elder, came through with his entire family, kids and grandkids. It was very clear. And he was just walking. You could tell it was like 8, 9 o'clock at night. And you could tell he was just really enjoying the fact that he was surrounded by his family. And I'm at the front. Right. And I see him and we acknowledge each other, and he kind of looks at me and he's like, "So what's your story? What do you do?" And I told him I was at UCSB. I didn't graduate, this, that, and the other. And he's like, do you get out there, you get engaged? I'm like, no, I've just gotten so cynical. And I'm like, 24, 25, talking about I'm cynical. Right. And he just like, he just leans back, looks at me and says, "Don't be cynical." And he says, "Activism is the antidote for cynicism." And I just paused and have reevaluated my whole thing right at that point. So just because I was cynical, right, just because I was tired or beleaguered, what gave me the right to think that I could just stop? You know, I talked to my mother, who is in her second career. She worked 30 years at the telephone company, started off as the old school switchboard operator, mm-hmm. right, worked her way up to management, retired, went back to school, got her teaching credential and her master's, and is now in her 18th year of teaching. And we talked about how the work never stops. Like, I asked her, like, there's no such thing as retirement, is there? She's like, nope, not at all, because there's so much to be done. So at UCSB, I work directly with students. I work in community affairs. And the reason why I've chosen this work is in large part as an undergraduate student, I was engaged in it, but also because... And it's part of my study, too. I'm a doctoral student in education at UCSB. And because there are countless examples, as Hanna Beth just indicated, there are countless examples of how when the youth are engaged and empowered and informed, that change happens, that things happen, even though the youth do not necessarily, see it that way. So when I talk to our students, and I say, here I grew up in the 70s, blah, 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 and you may look at the civil rights movement as though it's something that's separate from you, or that it's not a part of you, it's different from you. I'm like, that is actually you in a previous life. It was people just like you, where you are in your place in life right now in the university, particularly at Santa Barbara, which has a rich history of student activism affecting change that has reverberated around the world. The first Black Studies department in the country, the modern day environmental movement. It goes on and on and on. The first and only Chicano Studies PhD program in the country right here at UC Santa Barbara. And that's because students organize themselves, galvanize themselves, not by the tens of thousands or even the thousands, but just a few hundred or maybe in a few dozen who are committed and organized. And I tell them consistently, you can affect change. You will affect change. You know, the Marianne Williamson quote, like, that's what happens because you have done it. You've done it before. You're going to continue to do it again. So that's the belief that I bring to the work that I do because I see it. I see it day to day. And as trying as it can be, it's difficult, particularly this last year in Santa Barbara and in UCSB. We had a very, very difficult year, right? But I've also witnessed, you know, in the plight of all this travesty, students rise up and do amazing, beautiful, just momentous, just step up in ways that I could never imagine myself doing. And so that's the work that I choose to do. So in terms of this maladjustment piece, and speaking of voting, I just want to say also, look, I wasn't going to say it, but Hanna Beth put it out there. Also, for example, UCSB students have for the past 6 years and definitely the past two presidential elections registered more students to vote than any other campus in the country, over 10,000, and have more students actually out there voting than any other campus in the country. So I am very, very much inspired and take to heart exactly what Hanna Beth has said in terms of, like, you know, we have that ability here. I have no idea what I just wrote there. Oh, yeah. So it's challenging the notion that students are apathetic, right? In my opinion, in my experience, they're not. And in terms of this maladjustment piece, I was thinking about this in the shower where I do some of my great thinking. And I'm definitely maladjusted, as I think all of us are, to the devastation, the crimes of humanity. I have an image on my Facebook page of what probably is the massacre in Nigeria, which is grotesque and horrible. I have a colleague named Peter Bukart, I went to school with, who works for Human Rights Watch, who's currently in the Central African Republic working there to bring justice. I am maladjusted to all of that nonsense. I'm maladjusted to the criminal justice system in this country. For those of you who don't know that, you know, Eric Garner, the indictment against a police officer, just someone hit me the game. The indictment was that it was the choking that killed him by that one officer. But if you watch the full extent of the video, he was no longer being choked, but was still saying, "I can't breathe." So because of the specificity of the law, because he wasn't physically being choked, but was still alive after the choking, that's why that officer wasn't indicted. That's exactly why. That nuance of the criminal justice system, that is the thing that I think we need to be more vigilant about. Let me just speak for myself. I can be very, very angry and mad about the decisions. And of course, Mike Brown and countless and countless others, right? But when it comes to the criminal justice system, I think that we lack a collective understanding of how it works and why it works. That's why I think, you know, folks like Hanna Beth Jackson and her position in representing us is so very, very important. Two final things. I want to repeat and acknowledge and praise all the words of the panelists thus far. I agree with everything, and I'm sure I'm going to continue to agree. There was a saying that another elder shared with me back in the day in Hebrew, which says something to the effect of, "We are not expected to finish the struggle, nor are we excused from it." And I really take that to heart. I believe that, as Michael Fronte said, the personal revolution is far more critical and important than the first step in any revolution. In his song Music and Politics off their first album, Disposable Heroes of Hypocrisy. And I also believe that racism is not something that necessarily people of color need to be worried about. As Professor Madison at the Black Studies Department in at UCSB indicates, racism wasn't designed for black folks. Racism is designed to control white people, quote-unquote white people. The majority of the population, those are the minds that need to be controlled, not the 14% here or the 20% there. So when we're looking at this and talking about being maladjusted, I think we need to also consider how these constructs have come into place and who they are designed to control. And finally, and this is something that I share with my students and I'll share with you all, it's the Sioux legacy. The Creator created humanity and all that is, and wanted to give humanity the essence and the value and the answers, all the things that they would need in their lives to be able to be prosperous and loving and kind, but didn't want to give it to humanity right away. So the eagle said, well, give it to me. I will take it to the moon and hide it there. The Creator said, no, one day they'll go to the moon and they'll find it there. The salmon said, well, give it to me. I'll take it to the bottom of the ocean. And the Creator said, no, one day they'll even go there and find it. And then the buffalo said, well, give it to me. I'll bury it deep in the Great Plains. And the Creator said, no, even one day they will dig through the breast of Mother Earth and find it even there. And so Grandmother Mole, who has no physical eyes but sees with spiritual eyes, said, put it inside them. And the Creator said, it is done. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Helene Schneider. She was first elected to the Santa Barbara City Council in 2003 and is currently serving her second term. Prior to this position, she was appointed by Mayor Harriet Miller to serve as Commissioner for the Housing Authority of the City of Santa Barbara. Helene's professional background is in human resources management and includes over 15 years working in this field, previously for the local Planned Parent affiliate, and now as Senior Associate for HR Express, a local human resources consulting firm. She earned her BA from Skidmore College, received professional certification in human resources management from UCSB Extension, and passed the Professional in Human Resources National Certification Examination in 1998. She served as president of the Santa Barbara Human Resources Association in 2001 and received the State Leadership Award from the California State Council of the Society of Human Resources Management for her work. Her involvement in the local political area started in 1992, as a member of Jack O'Donnell's campaign staff for his successful re-election to the State Assembly. She also joined the Santa Barbara Women's Political Committee, where she eventually served as president in 1999 and 2000 and was on the board of directors for several years, 7 years.
Thank you. Thank you. A lot to think about and absorb in this time, and I appreciate being a part of this amazing panel and look forward to the final speaker as well. Don't go away, right? This is a lot happening. I also appreciate this happening during Martin Luther King Jr. weekend and remembering and re-remembering his speeches. I, as someone who was born 2 years after he was assassinated, to be able to remember that this isn't just a piece of history to put away in the books, but that it's a living piece of America that needs to be continued and talked about. I was very fortunate growing up, going to a school that before it was a national holiday, having an assembly where we would listen to his words and listen to the I Have a Dream speech. And to this day, it still gives me chills, each and every time I hear his words say it in the way that he does so well. Mm-hmm. And one of my other favorite quotes from him is the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. Mm-hmm. And it makes me think about, and as we were discussing all this morning, of how long it takes to get to where we need to go. And thinking about the creative maladjustment piece and my role in it in various capacities, whether it be mayor of a city or an activist with the Women's Political Committee or even as a professional in human resources management, another phrase, not by Dr. King, but actually it's not attributed to anyone. It says anonymous next to it, I think. It's well-behaved women rarely make history. And, you know, the thought of being able to speak up and to speak truth to power, to say what you believe to be right, to be true, even in the face of adversity, to be able to say things that you know others may think, but for whatever reason feel like they can't say out loud. And one particular thing in relation to social justice that comes to mind, and my role in it, very, very, very small role, but the way of being able to speak out and use whatever position you're in to move that arc towards justice, is in the case of gay marriage. And if you think about in the last 15 years what the national conversation was, I don't think we would have thought 15 years ago we would be where we are today, where state after state has one ruling after another basically saying it doesn't matter who you love, but that you love. And so in the name of love, going through that theme, talking about that particular issue, we're way back in 2000. I was fortunate to be on the Women's Political Committee Board as president and working with a coalition of activists in creating the No on Prop 22 Santa Barbara Coalition. I was talking about issues related to domestic partnership and marriage, and it was a statewide initiative that actually passed in the state, but South Santa Barbara County said no. And it was that collective piece that kept that, and that momentum kept moving, whether it was through pushing domestic partnership registrations and registries through the county or through the city and through the city's domestic partnership benefits, making sure they were part of it. To then, even in 2004, my first year on the council, where President Bush wanted to push a constitutional amendment, which for the very first time would actually curtail people's rights rather than expand them by pushing a Defense of Marriage Act constitutional amendment, and using the position where, as a city, where we didn't issue marriage licenses, we did things like dealt with public works and libraries and parks and recreation and public safety, but yet to take a position and to make the council speak up and say, no, this is wrong, and we would oppose it, was very important. So speaking up in that way, even at a time when today it seems like, especially here in Southern Santa Barbara County, it seemed like a no-brainer. Back then it wasn't always. And that was a big piece of terms of speaking out. Also, using your position on issues, we were talking about income inequality. And what is it that a city can do in certain ways? And first getting on the city, Santa Barbara City Council, and passing a living wage ordinance, which was very controversial. And it was a big issue during that campaign, and then moving on and following through with it, figuring out a way that what is exactly the city's role when it goes into contract with private entities, and making sure that public dollars aren't being used to subsidize poverty, so that you're not going to hire then someone who's going to have poverty wages so that then they still start putting themselves through other social programs because they can't afford the work that they're doing, even though they're doing it on behalf of the city. So that kind of conversation was a big one to talk about. In my role in human resources, I still do trainings, and one of the things, thankfully to a state law that actually makes people talk about preventing sexual harassment in the workplace, it's a state law that trains supervisors, that requires them every 2 years to remind themselves that it's not okay to sexually harass other people, things that you would think would be very common and very self-explanatory really isn't. And you look at one thing at one place after another where companies say and do things that are completely inappropriate. But taking the position of what can I do in my position and the knowledge I have and speak out to it, the trainings that I tend to do, and I've had the pleasure over the last 10 years to be able to talk to a number of companies, is not just tell you what the law is and how to keep away from being sued, but how do you create a culture of respect? How do you create a place where common courtesy is where you start from? And how do you create a place where we are human and we say and do stupid things sometimes and we make mistakes? What do you do in that situation to then turn it around and create a place where you can move forward in a way that everyone then becomes evolved and helps each other move to a better place, a place of respect, a place of common respect and common courtesy? And to acknowledge that something that may happen to someone else that you may not be involved with yourself does still affect you. And that is part of the philosophy dealing with, I think, that particular training. And even in the role of human resources, when you talk about compensation strategy, access to health care, child care was mentioned before. I like to talk about where it's a profession where the the personal, political, and the paycheck can all come together, right? Mm-hmm. And what a pleasure it is, and what an honor it is to be able to do work and to have a job and to be able to make a living doing things where you can promote the greater good. So currently on the City Council, a couple of things I'll just mention briefly that we're working on, and also looking at what position that you're in and allowing yourself to use your role in the way that you best can, but also allow others to work with you and do their role in the best way they can. And sometimes that means giving them more authority or responsibility that sometimes you may like to have yourself, but it's really their role to work on something. So in the issue related to homelessness, for example, where it affects everyone in one way or another. Obviously, it affects the person who's homeless the most. But what can we do as a city in terms of training our police officers to recognize mental illness, that instead of telling people to move along when they get a call for service, instead they engage with an individual, figure out what they need, connect them to the various services available, whether it's the VA or health services or social services, and then to housing, and bringing those pieces together and having people communicate with one another, focusing on a common goal and that collective impact of getting people off the streets and into housing. And a big, big piece of that, I think, is the language that we use. And talking about homeless people not as just those people, but that's been talked about a lot here too, but talking about them as individuals, of people with desires and dreams and wants and needs, and also challenges and ways that we can do to help them overcome those challenges. And so a big stretch for me as mayor, the last couple of years happened where I've always grown up thinking, you know, the church and state divide. And yes, there is a role that there's politics and there's public works in the sense of doing the public good on a governmental level and the faith-based community. But there's so many interactions between the two that should be. And I think Dr. King really exemplifies how to bring those two together. And I was speaking with a group of faith-based leaders a couple of years ago, and I said, well, maybe this is divine intervention, but this, you know, vision came to my head of an image of, instead of a wall between church and state, what we really should be looking at is a screen door. So yes, there's a division between the two in terms of each has their own place in our society, but we still want to talk to each other. We still want to see each other through that screen door, to feel the air in between, and once in a while open that door and allow one body person to come over to the other and vice versa and share those experiences and share that knowledge in order to create a common good and a common goal. So the creative maladjustment, I think, is a fabulous term. It's a way to question authority even when you are in a position of authority, to question yourself, to question if what you're doing each and every day is the best of your abilities. And I think Dr. King for sure has been someone who has resonated with me and many of us in keeping that dream alive, and to remember that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Willow Young, MAMFT, joined Pacificus faculty in 2000, became core faculty in 2005, and has served as director of clinical training before becoming chair of the counseling psychology program. Willow is a practicing psychotherapist in private practice, an IAAP certified union analyst, and a training analyst. She has supervised trainees and interns at various counseling centers and served as the mental health consultant to the families of migrant farm workers.
Thank you, Jennifer. And I just want to welcome the panel. As someone who works at Pacifica and isn't out and about personally in the community the way you are, to celebrate your accomplishments and your contributions. And now we can say your wonderfully creative, maladjusted selves. Really glad to have you here on a Sunday morning to be with us. So Diane Travis Teague wanted me to speak, and I'm really speaking for her, because as a young girl, I took it into my mind that I was going to the March on Washington. I was 12 or 13, and Diane wasn't able to go. She was in Tennessee, and there were so many people in this country that were not able to attend the March on Washington. But their hearts and minds were there, And Marn, thank you for leading us in song, because it was singing that brought people. People from all over the country came on buses. And so that this, you're riding in a bus on a road and your bus is singing, stop at a stop sign, you hear the other bus singing. Mm-hmm. It was with song that people came. And whenever someone stood on the stage and sang, whether it was a gospel group or one of the folk singers, Bob Dylan, whomever, the whole crowd started singing with them. So there was this common lending of voice. But it was, so to be a young girl in skirt and sneakers, I got on a bus at the Mount Vernon Unitarian Church, from which there were many buses leaving, and got off the bus, and the bus driver looked at me and he said, "See this bus, see this number, see this tree. At 5 o'clock, you'll be back here on this bus." You know, he felt responsible for this little kid. But it was, first of all, it's important to remember it was on a Wednesday. It was on a work day. So Washington took a break, and because traffic couldn't flow, there were buses everywhere. And so it was really a day of rest, a day of activation, and people were dressed up. They came in their work clothes, their Sunday best, and they came with their families. There were old, old people, and there were young people, and people had their babies. And lots of people milling and wandering and listening to King's voice, which was thunderous. And you had this feeling, especially when he was calling out. Remember, he called to the from the hills of Alabama and the curvaceous hills of California. That voice really was so deeply resonant and obviously heard and picked up by so many. But to be someplace and not be afraid, and to be with bodies, it's hot in August, it's hot and sweaty, and to be dressed up and yet free to wander. So it was sort of like a big picnic. People had their blankets laid out, shoes kicked off, lying in the grass, listening and being together. And it was years before that I think it was 1955 when Sister Rosa Parks refused to move. So the movement was years and years and years in the making. And many, many, many people make it impossible. So I feel that I was a witness to something pretty extraordinary in our time. But I remember when I applied to Pacifica, I became a student in 1990, and writing about that experience was an important part of my application process. Because somehow a stance was formed within me, sort of unconsciously, but just emerged. So that when I was in high school and people were joining sororities, that just, I wasn't going to join a sorority. And I took many personal and individual, sometimes silent stances. That's, I think we all do. We endure, we witness someone else experiencing something, and we stand by them with our presence of being. And that's something that I think now, as chair of our counseling psychology program, where our students by the second year, well really it's the summer of their first year, are out in community working with people. They are providing service, mental health service, and they're working in the trenches. They're working and experiencing unbelievable trauma and pain and suffering, much of which is a result of denigration and poverty and lack of opportunity, somehow being denied their most essential selves. So we work really hard in the program to host the cultivation of the creative maladjustment of our students to bring voice and stance to their own inner work so that they can go into community and be present and provide an opportunity for the voices of the people that they work with to be heard. So we do a lot of listening. And I often think that that's a form of activation, not just psychological activation, but it's a form of being active, that we listen and we are witness and we hold space. And it's quite a challenge sometimes in the classroom to experience racism, just unconscious things that people say. It just comes out, and it comes from who knows where, and people aren't always aware of it. And of course, we have students from all over the country, and we have students from diverse economics, socioeconomic backgrounds, and from culture, from story, from experience. And we're dedicated to holding space for those different voices. People have different ways of learning. And some people learn by listening and moving and being engaged, and other people learn by writing and reading. And we try to host all these differences of being in the classroom. I'm so grateful, Steve, for your vision of that, that diversity extends beyond color and culture to the way we are within ourselves, and to hold space for that. So it's an incredible honor to work with my colleagues at Pacifica in this effort. And that community is held by everybody. It's not just the professors who teach in the classroom. It's the housekeepers and the gardeners and the bookstore tenders and the librarians and the shuttle drivers. I think everyone who attends Pacifica and doesn't drive onto campus knows the extent to which the shuttle drivers hold space for stories and students. And I just want to say also that it really matters. So Tara, who's a student in our program, is always saying, thank you, thank you. And really, Tara, we have to say thank you to you. Thank you really for your voice and for being here and for holding your stance and your presence of being. And Kwame, please deliver this to Andre McRae, who, a student in our program from Akron, Ohio, who completed his thesis under much duress, as it, I think it is for many students. But tell him how important it was for us that he was here. And we think of him, his cohort members think of him, and we're so proud of the work that he's doing, just day by day, and it's not easy. He struggles, as many of our students struggle in their home communities. So, yeah. Jennifer, back to you.
Thank you. So I, in listening to all of your commentary, I was thinking about the monument, the King Monument. It's a large, how many of you have seen the monument? Some people have been there? So it's a large, it's a mountain of despair. It's from a King quote, that out of a mountain of despair, we will hew a stone of hope. And so it's a mountain of despair, and then from that middle part of the mountain pushed out is the statue of King. So he is the stone of hope that came out of this mountain of despair here. And I think a lot about that image in this mountain of despair. And I know, through my study of King, one of the things that he was a man who was very, very despairing towards the end of his life. He was very depressed, in part because of the shattered dreams, the unfulfilled dreams. He was a man who had, felt like for all he had not done enough. And that many of the changes that he had made were more cosmetic. His saying that it didn't do any good to get a black person to be able to buy a hamburger if they couldn't afford it. Sit down at a lunch counter and buy a hamburger if they couldn't afford the hamburger. And so he really came to this place of despair in his life that that the what was at the bottom of all the evils really was materialism, and our economic system just had to go. And I feel his despair. Many of us feel despair about so many ills in our world, and suffer with that. And King certainly suffered from some deep dark depression. Taylor Branch, who wrote all the books about King, the history books about King, was asked what would have happened if King had lived, and Taylor said, "I think he would have had a mental breakdown because he was in such in such despair." And here we are celebrating his life and his work. So I just wondered if some of you might address that question of how do you deal with your own, if you feel despair, have moments of despair, how do you deal with that, and what's the antidote to despair for you when you look at the how much there is out in the world, how much suffering there is?
Well, as a as a pastor of a church, you run into that quite a bit. Especially when you're trying to do things, accomplish things that you think are good for the community. Right now, we're building a 6-unit apartment complex, and we're still in, even actually though the sticks are going up, it took 6 years to get there. And so what happens is that you regardless of what is on your plate, and I think this is what happened with King. Even though you reached that point where you just want to say, "Oh, the heck with it! I'm ready to give this up," you look for the greater good, and you know it's going to be a cost to you, but you just keep driving no matter what. So sometimes the disparity of treatment that you go through and everything else, that the pressures of the world that come down on you, especially as a black man, you say, regardless, that's what, pretty soon you have to turn that venom into an appetite so you can eat it and throw it away. So you don't have to put up with it. I mean, it's there, but you can just, you just take a blind eye and say, "I'm going to persevere no matter what." And that's when God comes in, and you just, hey, when you get down on your knees, and there's been times in my life in the church that I'm in where I remember coming into the church and just crying because I was like, "God, can I get through this?" But making sure that you put God first, and I think Martin Luther King did that, and that's what kept him, was putting God first in his life and making sure that he held on to that. Because without that, you lose track of where you're going. And that's what I've done. And that's what a lot of people do. Even with people that are on drugs, you know, you go to AA and NA, and they talk about the higher power. So you have to have a focal point that you stay concentrated on in order to get through. So That's what I do. I stay focused on whatever the accomplishment is that I'm trying to accomplish, no matter what. And we felt the racism here in this town trying to build something. But we just keep pushing.
Thank you.
When you look at it in its totality, whatever the big complex issue is, it's overwhelming. But I think if you can figure out or see when one particular person has benefited from years of work, and that keeps you going. And the thought in my mind, as I mentioned, homelessness issues and how complex that is, and you look at the numbers and you find it overwhelming, but then you meet someone that you saw on the street who now has a home and connected services, and because of years of work and collaboration and systems that now seem to fit, helping that person become self-sustainable and seeing that transformation, that gives me hope. And that, you know, and there was one particular woman I would see all the time outside what was then Borders, knitting, very sweet woman, but had a huge, huge shopping cart full of her stuff. She actually had family in town, but did not want to live with them. And and she had some significant mental illness, and it took years of perseverance of various people, so many people saying, we need to get you to help you. And it was only until she was finally able to trust and say yes, that not only did that have to happen after so much time, but then that there was a place for her to go. And the challenge is sometimes when success happens, you don't necessarily see it when the success happens. So people noticed her when she was outside borders, but they didn't notice when she was no longer outside borders. And it even took me a few months to realize, where'd she go? And fortunately, I was able to ask our restorative police officer what happened. He goes, oh, right, she has a place that, and named it, you know, a nonprofit housing place. And a few months later, I actually went to that place, and there she is outside her own little apartment knitting, going, hello, Mayor Schneider, how are you? And, you know, and she's still the same person, but now has that community of support, and she was able to trust it. And that took years of work, and it still takes that kind of work, but that's what keeps you going.
Yeah, I think, you know, the quote, we're not expected to finish the work, but we are not excused from it, I think is, you know, life really is a journey and not a destination. I tell people life never ends well. That's true. But what happens in between, I think, that's so critical. And, you know, we can't expect that we're necessarily going to see those results. I think it was Dr. King who thought we'd have a woman president before an African American. But on that score, he was wrong. There are some of us who now believe that we've got to shoot for that goal, you know, in our lifetimes. But it may not happen, but it will happen. And so we don't always see the fruits of our efforts. But if we believe that with each conversation and with each new day and with each young person and our communities pushing that envelope forwards, whoever thought we would have it used to be a crime for white people to marry black people, and it used to be a crime for people of the same gender to love each other and to marry and to have families. I mean, there are all sorts of things, and yet then we see things repeat themselves continually. I don't think there will ever be a lack of bigotry in this world or a lack of racism. I just think people were imperfect, but we can overcome those feelings by education, by laws. I know some people don't think that, but I wouldn't be in the work I'm in if I didn't believe that we could affect behavior by the legal system, by the justice system, by creating those rights and obligations for all people and accountability and opportunity. So I just think we have to measure our successes in very small increments and hope and believe that that those things will happen even if we aren't here to see them.
You know, when I think in the public policy arena, there's these big challenges that we have, and you sometimes, as you muster up the energy and the strategy to tackle these issues, it's pretty daunting. And I think that the one thing that really helps me out, and I don't do enough of it, but it's really when you go try to live in the shoes of those individuals that are facing what you're trying to impact. You'll get a quick reminder and a quick motivation, and your passion will be renewed in a heartbeat. You know, we have compassion for those that have less, but do we really understand what that means? Have we really lived in their shoes? Have we spent a night in Casa Esperanza? Have we gone to the homes of some of the families that are two or three families in one garage? I think we all mean well, but when you really start feeling like you're getting frustrated or you're not seeing enough, just go live a day, an hour, in the life of those that we're trying to impact and who we're trying to change the world for. And I think you'll get that renewed sense of urgency, that renewed sense of compassion, and get back on that horse and keep at it.
I think it was Dr. King who said, let us not wallow in the valley of despair, but look into the shadow of hope. And when I start feeling despair, because I see a lot of failures in the communities in which I serve, and I see few successes, I try to look at the successes. I focus on that, just as I teach the power of our words and how we must transform the way we view ourselves and the way we speak of ourselves. My youth are not at-risk youth. They're at promise youth. So we shift how we speak, and we shift how we see things, and we take a walk along the beach, as the story says, the little boy trying to save the starfish, and the man who says, what are you doing? He says, I'm saving these starfish. And he says, you can't save them all. And he tosses one in, and he says, but I just saved that one. And we just have to remember, it's one at a time, one small step at a time. If we can just save one, we've done something. We've activated that call to action. And I think that's what it's about. Let's not wallow in the valley of despair, but let's look into the hope. Thank you.
Well, I think the essential has been said already, but I would like to add that at least I feel that suffering, my suffering, other people's suffering, has to be transformed in sacrifice, and in the real sense of the word, no, make something sacred, and try to give sense to that sacrifice and to that the suffering. I think that I understand the despair of Martin Luther King and of Gandhi and of the great men and women, because we also feel it when we get frustrated. But I think that, Gandhi, who was in a way one, I mean, he inspired Martin Luther King, insisted in this idea in the Bhagavad Gita, which means that you have to foster action and inaction at the same time. I mean, more action, but at the same time inaction, in the sense of getting deeper in the inside. This tension, which is also suffering, but it has sense. I think the big difference in life is to give sense to suffering. It's the only thing we can do. Sometimes the suffering ends, sometimes it doesn't end. But if suffering with sense, in a way, is some kind of happiness and hope. And in this way, we follow the example of Martin Luther King and the great women and men of the past. I will end with, remember that in the Red Book, there's a quote which in Liber Secundus, you read that the evil cannot sacrifice. It's impossible. The evil cannot sacrifice. So the good, it's a strong arm you have. It's sacrifice. And I think it's the idea of the non-violence. No, it's the suffering with sense. It overcomes everything. And that's, I think, is our challenge as humanity, to incorporate the real and profound sense of sacrifice, which, as you said before, is always related to the sacred, or to God, or whatever you want to tell it. So that, I think, is the challenge. Thank you.